Welcome again. At this time, we are reading John chapter 2, verses 1 through 11. This is Jesus turning the water into wine. Verse 1. The third day, there was a wedding in Cana of Galilee. Jesus' mother was there. Jesus also was invited with his disciples to the wedding. Now, they must have known who was getting married, perhaps a family member or a close friend. Let's continue. Verse 3, when the wine ran out, Jesus' mother said to him, "They have no wine." Jesus said to her, "Woman, what does that have to do with you and me? My hour has not yet come." In other words, Jesus was saying to his mother, why are you bothering me? What are you bothering me for? My hour has not yet come. In other words, it's not time for me to do these kind of things yet, okay? Verse 5, his mother said to the servants, "Whatever he says to you, do it." Now there were 6 water pots of stone set there after the Jews' way of purifying, containing 2 or 3 metrites apiece. 2 or 3 metrites, it says here in the notes, is about 20 to 30 U.S. gallons, or 75 to 115 liters. That's quite a bit. Jesus said to them, "Fill the water pots with water." So they filled them up to the brim. He said to them, "Now draw some out and take it to the ruler of the feast." So they took it. When the ruler of the feast tasted the water now become wine and didn't know where it came from, but the servants who had drawn the water knew, the ruler of the feast called the bridegroom and said to him, "Everyone serves the good wine first, and when the guests have drunk freely, then that which is worse. You have kept the good wine until now." This beginning of his signs Jesus did in Cana of Galilee and revealing his glory, and his disciples believed in him. Now, a lot of things to talk about here. First of all, people who like to get into the bottle, perhaps a little bit too much, like to use this whole passage as a justification. Well, you know, I can drink and I can do this and, you know, I can drink and I can get drunk because, you see, Jesus, he turned the water into wine, you see. You know, he was a wine bibber, it says, you know. What you got to realize here is that we are in a Jewish culture 2,000 years ago, and Jesus, you know, was a Jewish rabbi, okay? Now, of course, at this point in time, he was a youngster, so he wasn't necessarily a rabbi at this time. That makes it kind of strange that it says that this was the beginning of his miracles and his disciples believed in him, because where was his disciples when he was a young man, okay? So that brings another question into the whole story. So as you can tell here, we're not told a whole lot of detail. John doesn't give us a whole lot of detail here, just 11 verses. Now, in the historical accounts of Jesus' physical appearance, it says that we have numerous accounts of Jesus having long hair, okay, or longish hair, okay? Also, you notice that when he did have the opportunity to drink of the fruit of the vine, he passed it up at the Last Supper, or at the Lord's Supper, as they call it, the Passover. He refused to drink of the fruit of the vine. Now, taking those two clues into consideration and also knowing that Jesus is a fulfillment of everything that came before, it's reasonable to conclude that Jesus was under the vow of the Nazarite. Now, for those of you who are not familiar with the vow of the Nazarite, I encourage you to read Numbers chapter 6. That talks about the vow of the Nazarite. Now, there are a couple levels of obedience, a couple levels of holiness, you know, in the law of God. You can be just, you know, in the law of God and you're obedient to the law of God. You're observant, you know, you're a Torah observant, okay? That's one level. You're good. You know, you're righteous. You're good. But then there are those who are special. There's a special place. There's like a boost, so to speak, or like nitro to holiness, okay? There is like a premium level of holiness, and that's described in Numbers chapter 6, and that is the vow of the Nazarite. It's not mandatory for everybody to do this. It was mandatory for some. For example, Samson, John the Baptist. We know that these people were under the vow of the Nazarite because of what, you know, the angel said to their mother, actually, when they were pregnant with them, you know, don't drink of the fruit of the vine, this kind of thing. Taking that into consideration, one of the stipulations of the vow of the Nazarite is that a man is not supposed to cut his hair while he is under the vow, okay? That could explain why Jesus had long hair, okay? That could explain why Jesus did not touch the fruit of the vine, did not drink of the fruit of the vine, you know, at the Last Supper, because he was under the vow of a Nazarite, okay? Why wouldn't he be? Wouldn't he fulfill all aspects of the Word of God? Sure he would, okay? So to say that it's okay for you to drink and get drunk, to drink wine and all this kind of stuff, and to use this as an example, that Jesus turned water into wine, it's really not a very good example to use. It's really not a very good argument, because you got to understand here, in the original Greek manuscripts, in the original Greek, there's only one Greek word which means both grape juice and wine, okay? How do you know if it's just fresh grape juice or wine? Well, the only way to tell is the age of it, how long it has been bottled, okay? And so there is no Greek word that means alcoholic wine versus grape juice, okay? There are no two distinct Greek words. It's all one Greek word. Grape juice is the same Greek word as wine, okay? So to say that Jesus turned the water into wine, of course, you know, you would say, well, it's probably alcoholic wine. However, you know, you need to always take into consideration that this could be a less alcoholic wine than you think that it is, okay? Another thing is, a lot of people say that Jesus was a wine bibber, that he ate and drank, okay? So it's referring to two different passages. First of all is the passage where he was accused of being a wine bibber. Why was the Pharisees, why were the enemies of Jesus calling him a wine bibber? Because they knew that a holy man should not be a wine bibber, okay? And so if Jesus was a wine bibber, he wouldn't be holy and he wouldn't be righteous and he wouldn't be a savior. He'd be a sinner, not a savior. The fact is, if you say that Jesus was a wine bibber, then you are just basically agreeing with the enemies of Jesus. Don't do that. Another thing is that you can say, well, Jesus said that the Son of Man came eating and drinking. Well, again, you need to understand that the phrase eating and drinking is like how we say raining cats and dogs anymore. Eating and drinking just means with, you know, being joyful. Okay? I will just, you know, I come to this event, you know, eating and drinking, you know, in other words, just being joyful. It doesn't necessarily mean that you are a glutton or a wine bibber, okay? It doesn't necessarily mean that you come to pig out and to get drunk, okay? It doesn't necessarily mean that you actually even really came to eat literally and drink literally either. It's a figure of speech, okay? So don't use this passage of scripture to justify alcoholism or that kind of thing. I have a whole article on alcohol consumption on my blog. So don't forget to read that. You know, for those of you who are honest about it and you want to know more about what the Bible has to say, I strongly encourage you, recommend that you go to my blog and read that article. Until next time, God bless you and give you eyes to see, ears to hear, and a mind to understand, and show you great and mighty things as you call upon his name. In the name of Jesus, amen.